To be or not to be, that is the question.
The Royal Shakespeare Company set a high standard when it comes to the performance of the Bard's work. And to tread the boards with this prestigious troupe is a dream come true for many actors.
The Royal Shakespeare Company, I guess, has to be the greatest classical theatre company in the world.
I've taken the wrong end of it.
But can a group of amateur actors make the grade?
This is a knavery event to make me appear!
Okay.
When they perform alongside the RSC's finest in a groundbreaking production of...
Get you gone, you dwarf!
A Midsummer Night's Dream. Now, from this programme's title, you may be forgiven for thinking we're trying to find the best derrieres this land has to offer. But alas, that isn't so. The only bottoms you'll be seeing are of a Shakespearean variety.
When my cue comes, call me and I will answer. My next is Most Fair Pyramus.
I have had a dream.
Oh, God! My life!
In a bold move to mark 400 years since Shakespeare's death, the RSC will, for the first time, cast amateur actors to perform alongside the professionals as the production tours the country. It's a flagship production of Shakespeare's beloved comedy, A Midsummer Night's Dream.
Answer as I call you.
The dream is a story of young lovers eloping to a magical forest where fairies are up to mischief and, as it just so happens, a group of amateur actors known as the Rude Mechanicals are rehearsing a play for the Duke's wedding. Are you following? Good. Just your average everyday Shakespeare play, really.
I thank thee, moon, for shining now so bright.
From Truro to Glasgow, from Belfast to Norwich, the Royal Shakespeare Company's Erica Wyman, the play's director, holds auditions for amateur theatre groups to fill the key role of Bottom and the other Rude Mechanicals.
The audition process was quite extensive, so over about 5 months I met nearly 600 amateur actors.
Answer as I call you, Nick Bottom the Weaver.
Ready?
After much deliberation, the amateur casts have finally been chosen. And when the production arrives at the Marlowe Theatre in Kent, history will be made. For the first time ever, the Royal Shakespeare Company has cast a female Bottom.
The raging rocks and shivering shocks shall break the locks of prison gates, and Phoebus' car shall shine from far and make and mar the foolish fates!
I was very impressed with Lisa because she's got this delicious creativity and she's got real courage and she sort of doesn't care. I mean, I know now that she does worry about what people might think, but she gave a wonderful impression of someone who was just prepared to go for it. And that's what Bottom requires, this wonderful enthusiasm and daring.
And this opportunity means a great deal to Lisa.
I have always wanted to act since I was knee-high to a grasshopper.
Man by man, according to the script.
I auditioned for drama school and got into Rose Bruford College of Speech and Drama, and I studied drama there for 3 years. Unfortunately, as a female, as you hit 30, there are so few parts for women. And my career just absolutely took a nosedive. And after a year and a half, 2 years of being completely out of work and waitressing all the time to bring in the money or teaching, I made the really tough decision to give up acting. And it, to this day, it remains the hardest decision I've ever made in my life because I love it.
And there
Joining Lisa on stage in the roles of the other rude mechanicals are her fellow Canterbury players.
Be perfect and a duo!
I was really impressed with their comedy and their sense of invention and their sense of fun. I thought they were very brave.
I will console in some measure. To the rest.
Keeping this bunch in line for Erica is amateur director Sally Elkerton. But how will she feel about not being the only director on this project?
I did know that it was going to be a steep learning curve because I'm used to being the director and that this was going to be a much more collaborative approach.
Before any work begins on A Midsummer Night's Dream, Erica and her team must get their amateur casts in shape for the mammoth task that lies ahead of them.
Oh, it's looking a bit weird.
Using some new but rather temperamental technology, Erica attempts to set her amateur actors across the UK their first task in what's to become their Shakespearean boot camp.
It's on, there you are. Great, we got you. Sorry, mild interference from the southwest there, but we're fine.
Yes, we can! There's Canterbury, fantastic.
Can you see us?
I'm going to be honest with you, you're a little bit fuzzy, but we can figure it out. Have you got your letter? Yes, but we can see you, and you've got your letter. This is great news.
So we asked each of them to prepare a monologue or a duologue that we chose specially for them from a different Shakespeare play, so none of them from Dream, to stretch them. Most of them were tragic roles, roles that really needed them to engage absolutely seriously with Shakespeare's language and intent. And I wanted them to just see what happened if they trusted Shakespeare's words. Bye, guys. See you soon.
OK, that would usually be Kent County Council that maintain all the highways, so it's definitely a district council van. I work in customer services for local councils. I'll have to put you through to parking. Someone might phone up about their housing allocation. Right, OK, hold the line, I'll put you through to housing.
It could be that they've lost their dog.
The task given to Hannah is a tough one and a world away from her day job. In front of Erica and her associate director, Kim Sykes, she's to perform a monologue from Measure for Measure, playing Claudian, a young man imprisoned for impregnating his girlfriend outside of marriage.
To be imprisoned in the viewless wind and blown with restless violence round about the pendant world.
Brilliant, very well done, very good, very good, very good.
Kim is Erica's right-hand woman and will be assisting Erica on this production.
If your instinct is there, to come and talk to us and move, do it. Absolutely, follow through.
So today was a real breakthrough because Hannah learned how to think on the line and to have a need to communicate with the audience at the same time. To do those two things together is very difficult, and to be able to just stand on stage and say, I am here and this is what I need to say to you, rather than what I want to say to you or what I'm a bit reluctant about saying to you, this is what I need to say to you. And that was a real breakthrough for Hannah.
At the RSC in Stratford-upon-Avon, the wheels of the Midsummer Night's Dream machine are now fully in motion. Sets are being built, costumes designed. It's been decided to set this production in a 1940s bombed-out theatre. In London, the professional cast begin rehearsals with Erica.
And of course, as we say all this, it's like, 1,800 different.
But I know when thou hast stolen away from fairyland, and in the shape of Corin, sat all day playing on pipes of corn and versing love.
Meanwhile, in a hall in Canterbury, Sally prepares her players for the challenge ahead.
Just sit down. If this was my production, I wouldn't be feeling as nervy as I am now, because I'd be making decisions as we went along, and that'd be that, and that'd be that, and that. I'm not in that position. So, you know, it's not like that. It's a new experience for us all, and I'm sure we'll...
I went into teacher mode, really, because I taught for years. Right, OK, your exams aren't far away. We're going to hit the ground running now, and this is it.
In the story of A Midsummer Night's Dream, the rude mechanicals are rehearsing right, The Tragedy of Pyramus and Thisbe, a play that they plan to perform at the Duke's wedding. Sally has some new ideas she wants to try, inspired by the 1940s setting.
But let's just see if you can use that idea of being influenced by American films a bit more in this scene, OK?
Oh, Pyramus! my lady dear. No, no.
If this was a Sally Alkerton production, she'd come on dressed as a GI, as Pyramus, you see, but it ain't going to happen.
The RSC team are back in Kent, and all eyes are on the Canterbury Players. It's their first rehearsal with some of the professional cast, and it's also being streamed live to the other amateur groups around the country.
Repent you, the actors are at hand, and by their show you shall know all that you are like to know.
This lady doth not stand upon points.
I suppose the great challenge of this project has been to collaborate with a complex network of directors. So Sally here in Canterbury, of course, her 13 counterparts all around the country. And to trust them to make work that's going to fit into the production, but also for them to trust us, the directing team from the RSC, so that when we turn up and we have a slightly different view of things, or we have a new idea, or we want to unpick something that we think might have taken them in the wrong direction, that they're not offended by that. And I think that has been quite delicate sometimes.
How will Sally's idea for Lisa to play a significant scene with an American accent go down with Erica?
Thus die I. Thus, thus, thus.
I'm not sure. It's too cool for school. It's very held and framed and not prepared to go, here are my guts, I think.
In the American accent, we make a mistake. We looked at an option that we got rid of.
What dreadful doll is here?
I'm not going to lie, I was really pleased about that. I didn't want to play it in an American accent, but Sally wanted to give it a go. And ultimately, that's your job as an actor, is just to give everything a go.
Now, perhaps in the Sally Alkerton production of Midsummer Night's Dream set in the late 1940s, she might have it. I don't know. On my own, I might have decided it had to go. I don't know. Because I'll change things right up until the line.
Opening night at the Royal Shakespeare Theatre in Stratford-upon-Avon is just under a week away. With the amateur group from the West Midlands up first, the RSC's attention is firmly set on them. So all the Canterbury Players can do now is wait their turn. Sarah is an adult education tutor and a keen boxer.
We felt quite removed and in a little bit of a hiatus. A little bit frustrating because we've never worked like that before. When you get that build-up of that intensity, you expect that you're going to just follow it through with that sort of normal journey of going into the technical yourself and into the dress rehearsal and then the performances. And it felt a bit that something was missing.
Okay, here we are.
With 2 months to go until the production arrives at the Marlowe Theatre, the players are keen not to lose any momentum. Today they're visiting a fancy dress shop with a difference.
Hello everybody, welcome to the Old Ford Wartime House.
Good morning. If you'd like to follow us, we can go back in time.
Thank you very much.
It was a bit like going into Mr. Ben's magic shop, if anyone can remember that, where you walk through a door and you suddenly went through the back and this amazing world revealed itself to you.
The Old Forge wartime house in Sittingbourne is a living history museum. It's a place where make do and mend, rationing and digging for victory are still very much alive. So the perfect place to go if you're researching a production set in the 1940s.
Good morning.
Hello, pleased to meet you.
What are you making?
So this is icing for my chocolate cake. Wow, wow.
And the front room, the ladies doing anything in crocheting.
Sally and Sarah take to the kitchen to learn some ration book recipes.
Right, now we're going to put the jam in. So it's just about a teaspoon of jam, because you'd have been as quite frugal as possible.
While Hannah and Lisa are lucky enough to receive a vintage makeover.
You couldn't sneakily kiss a bloke, could you, in the 1940s without everybody knowing about it?
No.
That's brilliant. It's really elegant as well.
Adam and Sid seem to have pulled the short straw.
Morning. Morning.
Hello there, morning.
Mr. Frost, nice to meet you.
Hello, Mr. Frost.
Yes. We've got some heavy work. This tool's very heavy, you know.
Bless Sid, because me and him were put out in the garden to dig the earth, as they would have done back in the 40s during the war and things.
Even though these poor chaps are spending their day off digging over a veggie patch, It turns out they found some time for a spot of bonding.
So you've been acting since you were five then, Adam?
Since I was a child, Sid.
Yeah. And I've been acting since I was 50.
Well, couldn't get any more different.
You couldn't get any more different if you tried.
My dream was to go to drama school. Unfortunately, through various events, which can only be called life, I haven't managed to do that. I do something very different.
By day, Adam works as a data analyst. But by night, Adam performs as a fire breather for festivals and other events. But does he still harbour the dream to become a full-time performer?
As amateurs, sort of have the best of both worlds. We do have a steady income, we do have a base, but I've got to be honest, I would love to be in the professional world if I could.
I'm going to have a cup of tea. Do you want a cup of tea yourself? I'll go and get what you've got.
Oh, I'd love a cup of tea, Mr. Frost.
Do a bit of hard work beforehand, though. All right, thank you. Carry on.
Sid is not a fire breather, nor does he hold any desire to go pro.
I'm a semi-retired chap who works as a gardener. And I'm relatively new to acting. I've only been doing it for 10 years. My wife, Jill, has always said you've really got to get hobbies other than doing things. So when she saw the advertisement in the local press for the community opera, she said, let's go along and do that. And we did. And since then, I don't think there's been any time when I haven't been rehearsing or performing in some play or musical show.
With the day drawing to a close, Sally gathers everyone together to say thank you and to sample her and Sarah's 40s food.
Kentish pasties!
Thank you.
Don't you look fantastic?
Bye-bye, 1940. Thanks for your time.
Meanwhile, the tour begins to make its way across the land. Receiving rave reviews. But can the Canterbury Players live up to such great expectations? Whilst the RSC is busy on tour, Sally continues to run her own rehearsals. But with the Marlowe dates now clearly on the horizon, Lisa is beginning to feel the pressure.
You see an aspect of your own, do you?
I am panicking because I am playing a man's part. And I think it's just dawned on me that it's a lot of pressure because I'm scared that people aren't going to like it, that people are very traditionalist when it comes to Shakespeare, and a lot of people aren't going to like the fact that there's a woman playing the part of Bottom.
And there is not a more fearful wild fowl than your lion living, and we ought to look to it.
Lisa's an actor. Actors go through periods of lacking confidence in what they can do. When they get out on the stage, you know, it's a pretty dangerous tightrope to walk, in emotional terms. That's natural. That is part of what I call the process. Because if you don't go through that, then there's probably elements of the work you don't work hard enough at. It's hard.
Tonight we've got a rehearsal, and it's the first rehearsal that we've got with Kim, who's coming down from the Royal Shakespeare Company. So we've not had anybody at all working with us since the middle of February. So we've been on our own since then. So this is the first proper input that we've had with the Royal Shakespeare Company and them seeing what we're doing or what we've done and whether it's any good.
But even Kim's imminent return hasn't eased Lisa's nerves.
If you asked me if I would like to do it again, the answer would probably be no, because the waiting period between the middle of February to now has just been just the oddest, most uncomfortable time.
Here we go.
Canterbury Players perform on Tuesday evening for their first show at the Marlowe Theatre here. And this week I'm just doing some final bits of preparation, some final tweaks to get them ready to go on stage and perform in front of an audience.
Some of your French clowns have no hair at all, and then you will play barefaced.
Very good. Well done, Sally. Really well done. You've really let their instincts reign. I'm going to make a couple of suggestions. So what if you have never put on a play together before?
Never what?
Put on a play together before.
Kim has come in and thrown some new ideas at them, some ideas that we've explored before and kind of ditched, and brought those all back into the mix.
What if you've never seen Bottom perform before? Let's just have a look at it, just with that in mind.
Let the audience look to their eyes. I will move storms. I will condole in some measure. To the rest.
And yet, we seem to be changing everything, but that's fine. I think we expected that we would have everything would be turned on its head once we got here this evening and once Kim arrived.
Tell me how it felt.
Completely different.
Very different dynamic.
Very different, yeah. Very different dynamic. Very
different. The wait is almost over. The tour has arrived in Canterbury. But there's still plenty to do to make sure that A Midsummer Night's Dream is the hottest ticket in town.
Just imagine the perceived weight of expectation that's on you for people not to say, well, what a bunch of amateurs, they were no good anyway. Squeaky bum time, as Sir Alex Ferguson would put it.
Erica puts the final touches to the players' performances.
Lisa, the only thing I'd say is I think it's quite helpful if To the Rest is her attempt to be a disciplined actor,
yes.
Who, do you know, it's a return entirely to Don't Let Me Take Up Too Much Time.
Yes.
The actors are called one by one to try on their costume for the very first time.
The costume fitting is mad because in the amateur world, you go around charity shops and you buy your own costume 99.9% of the time. But with the Royal Shakespeare Company, I mean, those people are genius and they must be the most organised people in the world.
I'd take the wrong end off.
It was magnificent putting the clobber on for the first time. Certainly my costume reminded me very much of David Jason's Granville from Open All Hours. So all I lacked was the bike.
Feels good.
The stage is set. And all of a sudden, the first performance is a mere 24 hours away.
And I did some work with these guys.
Erica has called the entire company to the auditorium for a special announcement.
I needn't tell you, I don't think, that we are making history this evening. Because Lisa Nightingale will be the first woman to play Bottom for the RSC. As Lisa said to me yesterday, and I feel much the same, it suddenly seems impossible that a man could ever play that part, which is good news.
No more rehearsals. No more waiting. After the best part of a year's work, the day has come for the Canterbury Players to share a stage with the Royal Shakespeare Company.
Yeah. We're nearly doing it.
I can't believe the journey we've been on. It's quite emotional sitting out there watching it, actually, and thinking, you know, where we were a year ago. And it's fantastic, and really go out there and sell yourselves and sell Canterbury Players and sell the Royal Shakespeare Company because you've got it all at your fingertips.
When we first got on for the first scene, I think there was a little bit of natural nervousness of, oh, wow, there's a lot more people here than usual.
Francis Snoops, the bellows mender.
Here, Peter Quince.
You must take Thisbe on you.
What is Thisbe?
laugh.
Oh, nay, Faith, let me not play a woman. I have a beard coming.
It's big relief. Massive. It just sort of builds, and then you just go and, and then it just goes like a flash, and it's a blink, and then suddenly you're backstage, and you've done it.
And I may hide my face. Oh, let me beg this be too. I will speak in a monstrous little voice. This new.
I probably had something to prove to myself that I could do it, that I could take on that challenge.
Oh, monsieur, I must.
She's confident. She's sexy. She's very individual. It's quite a subtle performance, and I think that she's magnificent.
Ready? Scratch my head, Peas Blossom.
The stakes were really, really high, and we wanted it to be good because we put that much love into it.
Fly masters, help!
For us, we'd never actually worked with the professional cast before. The whole thing was a bit of a revelation, really.
Why do they run away?
I don't think Erica Wyman will ever know what experience she's given to me and to everybody else. It has been utterly magical.
Kiss me through the whole of this vile wall.
Was just a little bit tense at the beginning. Not bad, pretty confident, but a little bit tense. And then they relaxed and it was completely wonderful to watch. It was great. And Pyramus and Thisbe, I mean, it was a groundbreaking moment. Lisa's bottom, you know, has made history. First time a woman's played bottom for the RSC, and she did it in style.
And what did the paying public make of this ambitious production?
I think it was amazing, and I think everybody done really well.
Perhaps you could enlighten us. I had no idea which the amateurs and which the professionals.
We actually programmed, you couldn't tell.
Yeah. Lots of people in really good faith have said, we couldn't tell the difference between the professionals and the amateurs. And I say, why should you be able to? I mean, I haven't been that rude to say that to people face to face necessarily, but my big question would be, why should you be able to?
A Midsummer Night's Dream played for 6 more performances at the Marlowe Theatre and received rave reviews. But what happens when the dream is over?
Hey!